in the studio from Faster Pussycat. We have Tamey, Greg, and Brent. Guys, good to see you.
What's happening?
How you
doing? When was the last time you were here? Didn't you host the ball last time?
Yeah, about a year and a half ago.
I got kicked out of night, and you guys took over. It's appreciated. I wanted to know that. Tonight we're featuring behind-the-scenes look at the Concrete Metal Convention, which took place last weekend in L.A. Tamey, you were on the artist panel?
Yeah.
How was that?
It was fun. I didn't really say much, but I was just like up there, just kind of low-keyed and listening to everybody else talk.
What was your favorite part of
it was kind of funny that Robert Sweet and King Diamond were like sitting next to each other. That was kind of on the panel.
Were they whispering to each other too? Or?
Oh, I couldn't tell, but Anthony from the Chili Peppers was really funny.
Mm-hmm. Who do you think did the seating arrangement though, to have those two sitting next to each other?
Probably Lon.
Yeah, that sounds about it. Since your debut album, how have things changed in your eyes, scene-wise, in Los Angeles?
There's a lot of different stuff out there. There's a lot of one scene, like the rock scene, there's a lot of the same style band, but then there is a lot of like Red Hot Chili Pepper type bands and stuff like that. I mean, there's anything you want out there you can see. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, the scenes themselves, like the rock scene itself, every band looks the same, you know. After something's big, everybody cops on it, but it's, you know, that happens anywhere, I think.
Now, with your new album, which has been out for a month now?
Almost 3 weeks now.
Is Faster Pussycat still sporting the glam look, style, sound?
I don't know, whatever you call this.
Well, I mean, not exactly. That's why I asked what your own feeling is.
I don't know, you can call it whatever you want. I don't know.
We just got kind of pegged in that whole term that came out at that time. But, I mean, sometimes we look like this, sometimes we look a lot worse than this, mm-hmm. you know? So it's different night to night. And when you're on tour, you don't really get to shower as much and stuff. So you look pretty bad.
I can tell.
You smell getting over there?
All right, hang with us a little bit longer. We'll be talking about the new album in a bit. Right now we have Michael Monroe, Dead, Jail, or Rock and Roll.
All right.
Writing and producing and getting the whole brand new album together, Wait Me When It's Over, after the success of the debut album.
It took us a long time. We got home, we toured for like 9 months on the first album, and we came home thinking that we're going to be ready to do a record, so we started rehearsing and trying to find a producer, and like all the producers that we thought at first were booked, and then we just went through producer hell trying to find the right producer, and then it comes like, we came home in like April, mm-hmm. something like that, and then it comes January, mm-hmm. and we're still like, we don't have a producer, and we're like going, are we gonna do a record, or, you know, what are we gonna do? Uh-huh. And then we hooked up with John.
The good thing about the time, though, is we got to try a lot of different stuff, you know, and we rehearsed for like a year and a half, so we got to try out a lot of different arrangements and just take our time with writing the songs and making sure they're perfect before they get on the album, you know.
I mean, we go through, we like get a bunch of 8 songs and narrow it down to 5 and demo them and then take 3 from that. And, I mean, we went through so many songs just for these 12 that are on the album.
Was there any word at all about the sophomore jinx?
No, because we had more time. The first time we were out about a year, we were together about a year when we did that, and so this time we figured, I mean, if you know, 4 months went by and we were already done with the second album, I'd feel kind of weary about it, but since we had so long, I mean, it was lousy waiting that long, but I mean, we got something good out of it, you know?
Mm-hmm. So usually the sophomore jinx comes too when your first album's platinum and really huge, and then it's like, wow, then your second album just goes or you break up or something, but our first album was successful, but not real huge.
Yeah.
Our album's only been out for 3 weeks now, and it's already doing better than the first one.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really?
We've hit, you know, 60 on Billboard.
Yeah. And
our last album never made it up. It was 97 was the highest it made. Oh. So, I mean,
we haven't toured yet or done anything.
We haven't toured, and the video just came last week.
Well, don't tell anybody. We'll just let it keep going up like that. We're going to take a look at Poison Ivy right now.
All right.
Tell us about the video. How did the shoot go?
It was physical. It was bloody, actually.
Bloody?
We were running all over. It was just us, and we were running everywhere, and the cameraman was just... He was really cool, this guy named Tony. He was a big battalion dude, and he was nailing us with the camera, and I had a bloody nose, and he had a bloody nose.
And I had a bloody lip.
Yeah, I had bloody fingers, blood all on my
feet,
guitar.
Because the stage was... The floor was cement. It was painted, mm-hmm. and it's like I had these little shoes on, and it's like after 10 hours, they just wore through the bottom of my shoes.
Jeff Stein directed it.
Yeah.
He did a good job. I'm happy with it.
So are we actually going to see any of the blood now in the video?
No.
If you look close on my guitar, I think you can see it.
A little drop
close on the guitar, yeah.
Okay, here it comes. Faster Pussycat.
This is on.
Yeah.
And can we start tour October 24th? We start in Austin, Texas.
Mm-hmm. How long will that take you?
That'll take
nine
us up.
Months again?
That'll take. We'll take. It'll take us up until December. Then we're going to Europe, and we're going to do England, and we're going to do our first headlining show at the Hammersmith, which
oh, that's cool.
Last time we played there with Guns, and mm-hmm. that was fun, and this will be cool. And then we'll come back in January and like hopefully hook up with another, you know, support mm-hmm. arena tour.
Cool. Now, a lot of bands these days have, I mean, even The Who has a 900 number you call up and you get to hear about their personal lives. Now, you guys have a phone number as well, only it's toll-free.
Yeah,
it's,
we don't make thousands of dollars off of it.
Well, actually, it is a toll call, but it's not
it's
a 900
just, well, it's
number.
A, it's yeah. like them calling our house.
Yeah.
You know, it's just a message machine that so we can leave
dates and stuff. You know, we actually should have one of those. I mean, you make a lot of I guess you make a lot of money off them, and all the bands that like have a lot of money, I guess have them.
Yeah,
we have no money, and we should
don't want to charge. $2.
I mean, we've had the cat line since we first started. I got it as a thing to put on for booking information when we played the local scene because mm-hmm. I didn't want them calling my house, so I got the service.
Mm-hmm. The number should be on the screen right now, as a matter of fact. And this is at your house?
It's actually a machine. It's actually our voices on it, but it's not like actually in our house.
How are
the people that always call there and go, pick up the phone, pick up the phone, guys. Like, it's not, we don't actually hear it until we call in and check them.
Well, it'll be very busy, I'm sure, as of right now.
No kidding.
Hey, guys, thank you very much for dropping by.
Hey, thanks for having
us. Good luck with the album and on the road, and of course when you come back in the area.
Yeah,
all right.
We'll be back in two
invade
you.
And when I call and say pick up the phone, will you then pick up the phone?
No.
Here's Queensryche, Revolution Calling.